Hello everybody. In our last lecture, we discussed about the functions of complex numbers. Now today, I'm going to discuss about the limit, continuity and differentiability, mainly the differentiability of complex valued functions of a complex variable. Over here, let's start with the idea of neighborhood. You all know the idea of neighborhood in a two-dimensional plane. So over here, if we are going to define that idea, the idea remains same, that neighborhood of a function, it is actually neighborhood of a point, it's actually a set, mainly a circular set or maybe rectangular set. It should be an open set surrounding that point or containing that point. In case of circular region surrounding that point, we call it circular neighborhood. It may be a rectangular neighborhood as well. So that is all about neighborhood. Nothing new is there. The idea you got in case of functions of two variables. If we have simply a function of two variable and the domain of definition of the function is a subset of a two-dimensional plane, then neighborhood of a point, let's call it maybe x0 comma y0. Let us call it the point p0. Okay, neighborhood of a point p0 is this kind of set. This should be the set of all points x comma y, such that of course over here the distance between x y and the point x0 y is. How do we define the distance? You can define the distance by the Euclidean rule, that x minus x0 whole square plus y minus y0 whole square, that should be less than some positive number delta. Okay, and this set is called the delta neighborhood of the point p0. Okay, this set is called the delta neighborhood of the point p0. So over here x comma y, this is actually a point in the two-dimensional plane R2. Okay, this should be a point in the two-dimensional plane R2, and we know that the set of complex numbers is nothing but the two-dimensional plane along with two operations defined by addition rule and multiplication. Okay, so addition and multiplication, these two rules are some extra information in the set of complex numbers, and the set of all complex numbers along with these two operations, it can be proved that this set forms a mathematical entity that is called field. Okay, so in place of R cross R, we can write it as R2, or in place of R comma R, we can call it, this is the set of complex numbers, this is an element in the set of complex numbers C. And over here we can remove this square root symbol and we can write delta square like this. So this is a circular neighborhood, circular delta neighborhood of the point p0. Similarly, we can define rectangular neighborhood and other kind of neighborhood. I am not going in detail of all these definitions. Okay, so that's all about neighborhood of point p0. Okay. Next, the idea of limit of function. Limit of a function. Now, what is this limit of function? Suppose f of z, as I defined earlier over here, that this f is a function from A to B, where A is a subset of the set of complex numbers and B is another subset of the set of complex numbers. The point Z is taken from the domain set capital A, so that we can write W is equal to f of z. We can write this expression as f of z. Got it? W is equal to f of z. So I'm going to define the idea of limit of this kind of function. Now, how to define the limit of this kind of function? Over here, limit of a function means that for each epsilon greater than 0, there exists a delta greater than 0, just the same epsilon beta definition that we discussed in case of real variables, in case of functions of real variables. For each epsilon greater than 0, there exists a delta greater than 0 such that distance between the function f of x and its limit, in place of f of x we should have f of z minus its limit L. You see over here this number L may be a complex number, may be a real number. So function minus limit, this difference should be less than epsilon whenever distance in between z minus the point may be suppose p0. P0 means we can denote this point p0 by this kind of coordinates x0, y0, and we can also write this z0. We can also write this z0 is equal to the point x0 plus I into y0 by simple notation. So this can also be written as an ordered pair x0 comma y0. Okay. So we can say over here, whenever z minus z0 is less than the quantity delta. Okay. And this delta should be a function of epsilon, and this z is maybe equal to z0, may not be equal to z0. In general, z is not equal to z0. That's why we should write 0 less than modulus of z minus z0 less than delta. Okay, and it can also be proved that this delta is not only dependent on epsilon, it is actually dependent on the point under consideration, that is the point z0. And if this relation is satisfied, then we say that the limit of the function f of x exists. This limit z tends to z0, z tends to z0, this kind of limit, I think I should maximize it a bit. Okay, hopefully this is clear to you. Limit z minus z0, limit z tends to z0 of f of z, that is equal to L. So over here L is actually a in general a complex number, that's why we can also write it as L1 plus I into L2. Okay, where L1 and L2 are their real and imaginary parts. L1 and L2, they are actually real numbers, but L2 is the imaginary part of L and L1 is the real part of L. Okay, real part of L. This is the definition of limit of a function. And it can be proved that we also write it in this fashion as well. We can also write it this notation in this way, that f of z tends to L, this expression f of z this tends to L as as z tends to z0. We also write it in this way. So this is about limit of a function of complex variables. We can prove these results. I am not going to prove all these results. I am just stating these results for your sake, for the completeness of this discussion on. Because the proof of all these results are not actually included in our syllabus. So I am I am going through these results in a fast forward fashion. We can prove a result. It says that we can prove a theorem. We can prove a theorem. The theorem says that if f of z tends to L as z tends to z0. Okay, what is f of z? Suppose this f of z is equal to u plus I into v. Okay, u plus I into v. What does it mean? It means that u should be a function of x comma y and v should also be a function of x comma y. I is the imaginary number root over of minus 1. Suppose this quantity u plus iv, that is represented as f of z, that is this is tending to L, and what is L? L is equal to suppose L1 plus I into L2. This is tending to z as this tending f of z tending to L as z tends to z0. And what is z? Of course, over here this x comma y means this z, or x plus iy, that is actually z. And what is z0? Z0 is actually the number x0 comma y0, or x0 plus y0. Got it? So if this f of z converges to L as z tends to z0, then this function u of x comma y, okay, this real part of the function f of z, this f of u comma u of x comma y converges to L1 and g of x comma y that converges to L2 as x comma y converges to x0 y0. We have to write it. This expression in bracket, as x comma y converges to x0 comma y0, as x comma y converges to this point x0 comma y0. And this result is also, the converse result is also true. The converse result is also true. Okay, so these are few results which relate the limit of real and complex, real and imaginary part of a complex valued function with the limit of the function f itself. So we can say that over here, if conversely u converges to the number L1 and v converges to the number L2, then it can be proved that the original function f of z actually converges to L as z tends to z0. So I'm not going to prove all these results. Okay. And in case of continuity, one can prove that in case of continuity, this z becomes is equal to z0, and this f of this L, this limit, this L becomes is equal to f of z0. So that's all about the continuity of a function of f z. So this similar result would also be true in case of a continuous function of a function of complex numbers. In case of continuity of a function of complex numbers. So I am not going to the continuity. Rather, I am trying to directly go to the definition of differentiability of a function. This is actually the fourth part of your syllabus that I should introduce over there. So let us first introduce the definition of differentiability of a function, of a complex number. So what we have, we say that suppose first of all, let me let me show you the small or brief definition of this function. We say that if the limit z tends to z0, this kind of limit, if the limit if limit z tends to z0, f of z plus h minus f of z divided by h, this limit exists, then we say that f is differentiable, f is differentiable function of z at the point z0. Okay, we say that the function f is differentiable function of z at the point z0. This is a very brief definition, and we represent this limit by the expression f prime z0. F prime z0. So that is about the definition of the function of the differentiability of a function of a complex number z. So if this limit exists, we can also define this derivative in terms of this kind of epsilon and delta notation, because the idea of limit is always represented in terms of epsilon and delta notation. And in this kind of definition, I should emphasize on the fact that z converges to z0. It is simply a convergence. Remember that z converges to z0 means, let me show you through this kind of picture. Just a minute, please. Suppose over here, where is the, this? Suppose over here, this kind, this may be a point, maybe the point x0, y0. X0, y0. Okay, and this may be the point x comma 1. So we denote this point x comma y by the notation z, and this point is denoted by the notation z0. All right, now you see this x comma y converges to x0 y0. The question is that along which path this point xy converges to the point x0 y0. Okay, answer is that the point xy may converge to x0 y0 along any arbitrary path. It may be a straight line, it may be this kind of arbitrary path, or it may be any other arbitrary, this kind of circular path. Got it? So this kind of convergence does not depend upon the path along which this point xy converges to the point x0y0. You should remember that whenever we have more than one variable, over here the complex number z can be considered to be as a collection of two variable, or you can consider it as the ordered pair of two variables. So whenever we have this kind of idea, then the convergence does not depend upon the path. We can simply say that xy converges to the point x0, y0, and gradually whatever be the path, whatever be the path, gradually the distance between x, this kind of point xy, and the distance between x0, y0, the distance between these two points would gradually tend to zero. That's all. It does not say anything extra about the path until and unless some specific information is given on the movement of the point xy or the point z. Until and unless such specific information is given on the movement of this point z, we should always remember that this point z is moving towards the point z0 along any arbitrary path. Got it? So you please remember this result. So over here, let me remove this one. Okay. So over here, this point z converges to z0 along any arbitrary path. So whenever we have the idea of limit, z should converge to z0 along any arbitrary path. And by chance, if it is found that along two different paths, the value of this limit is, the value of this limit are different along two different paths. You see, it can be proved that whenever the limit exists, the value of that limit is always unique. Okay. It would not have more than one value. So suppose by chance along two different paths, when z is moving towards z0 along two different paths, suppose we have two different values of the limit, then we should conclude that the limit of that function does not exist, because the it can be proved that whenever the limit of a function exists, by whatever definition you follow, this epsilon delta definition or this kind of limit kind of notation, it can be proved that whenever the limit of a function exists, it is always unique. So if by chance along two different paths we have two different values of this limit, then we should conclude that the limit of the corresponding function does not exist. Clear? So that is the definition of differentiable function. Now, is it clear to you, everybody? Sobar kache ki idea gulo clear holo? Karo kono jaygay kono question ache? Hello?
No, sir.
No, sir.
No question. Okay, so এবার আমি একটা question করতে চাইছি. Suppose try to answer this question. Okay, I need your feedback. In case of তোমরা already function of several variable তো কিছু study করেছো. Hello. Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir.
You studied the function of several variables little bit, the definition of limit. Is it so?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so please tell me, have you studied the idea of differentiability in case of function of several variables?
No, sir.
No. All right, so over here I should just ask one question, that suppose if you consider, say, this kind of number z, this kind of number h is a complex number, okay, and z is also a complex number, so that z plus h is a complex number. Now what is h? I should over here write, I should write z tending to z0. In case of that, we should write that h tends to 0, because it is all about h. And in place of z0, I should write Z0. That was a mistake that I did. I'm sorry. Now, the question is that, suppose you see over here this z0, this is actually a point like x0, y0. Fine. So h should also have this kind of representation. Maybe h is equal to, what is it? Suppose this is equal to h1 plus I into h2. Now I am trying to ask you a question that this expression should be written in this way: h1 comma h2. And if you want to write this expression in this way, over here you see this expression is equal to, what is this? Suppose this f of z is equal to u x comma y plus I into v x comma y. Fine. But whenever we have this h, some complex number divided by a complex number, could we do this kind of operation just simply by a ordered pair of real numbers? My question is that, could we do this kind of operation without defining a complex number, just by a ordered pair of real numbers like h comma y? Because it appears that complex number is not is actually an ordered pair of real numbers h1 comma h2. So would it be any problem if we try to make this kind of manipulation just by division of some quantity by an ordered pair like h1 comma h2? Now, if it is a valid operation, then what for we require to define a complex number, something extra? If it is a valid operation, then what is the reason behind defining a complex number? We could simply bypass the definition of complex number, and we could simply develop some similar theory in the two-dimensional real number system. You please think over it. Try to extract certain definite conclusive answers. Now, so let's continue with the definition. Definition of this kind of differentiable function of z. Now, you told me that you did not go through the differentiability of a function of two variables. So I think I should introduce the idea of differentiability in case of function of two variables. Otherwise, it would be a bit difficult to you. So let me first introduce the definition of differentiability for a function of two variables. What is this? Differentiability of a function of two variables. What is this? I am trying to define this idea of differentiability with respect to the function u. Okay. We have a function. The function, suppose u of x comma y. We already defined what is u. U is actually the real part of the function f of z. So the function u of x comma y is said to be differentiable at the point, say, z0. z0, what is this? z0 is equal to x0 comma y0. If delta u, what is delta u? Delta u actually this difference, u of x0 comma y0. x0 plus h comma y0 plus h minus u of x0 comma y0. If this delta u is equal to this expression is represented as, if this delta u is represented as this kind of capital A into H plus capital B into K plus epsilon 1 into H plus epsilon 2 into K, where capital A and capital B are independent of H and K, but these two quantities epsilon 1 and epsilon 2 are functions of H and K such that these quantities epsilon 1 and epsilon 2 both are tending to 0 as h comma k is tending to 0 comma 0. Okay, so this is the idea of or the definition of differentiability of a function. Differentiability, alright. If this difference over here, mind it, h is the increment in the value of x, and k is the increment in the value of y. Okay, so these are small quantities. Generally, this h is written as delta x or increment in x, this k is written as increment in y or delta y. Got it? And it can be proved that this capital A and capital B are nothing but, it can be proved that capital A is equal to the partial derivative del u del x. It can be proved that capital A is the partial derivative del u del x, and capital B is the partial derivative del u del y. It can be proved that this capital A and capital B are the partial derivatives of u with respect to x and y. Got it? And this expression A h plus b k, this expression, h is represented as delta x and b is represented as delta y, and this expression, this a into h plus b into k, this expression is written as differential of u. Got it? Differential of u, this expression, this a into h plus b into k, this is written as the differential of u. So what is differential? Differential of u is actually u partial derivative with respect to x. I am writing it by this kind of suffix notation, ux. What is h? H is actually dx. So we can write it as dx plus capital B means u suffix y, the partial derivative of u with respect to y. And what is k? K is actually dy or delta y, increment in y. So that's why this expression, this is called differential, or the differential of u. Okay, so you need to remember this results regarding the idea of differentiability for a function of two variables. This is the definition of differentiability, delta u is equal to this. And it can be proved that there is a necessary and sufficient condition of differentiability. It can be proved that a function is differentiable. I am just writing it as a theorem. A function u of say x comma y is differentiable if and only if a necessary and sufficient condition. If and only if limit x comma y or h comma k, you can say h comma k tending to 0 comma 0, h comma k tending to 0 comma 0 of this expression delta u minus du divided by root over of h square plus k square plus k square, if and only if this limit is equal to 0. So if this limit exists but this limit is not equal to 0, then it can be proved that the function u is not differentiable, or in other words, we can say that the function is not expressible in this fashion. And conversely, if the function, if u satisfies this relation that delta u is equal to ah plus bk plus epsilon 1 h plus epsilon by 2k, where epsilon 1 epsilon tending to 0 as h comma k tending to 0 0, then it can be proved that the limit of this function, this limit is always equal to 0. Okay, so this is a necessary and sufficient condition. That's why in exam, sometimes if anybody is asked to prove certain given function to be differentiable, then at that point we compute this expression, and if this limit is equal to 0, then we compute that the function is differentiable at that point, or we can say that function satisfies this relation, the definition of differentiability. And if this limit is not equal to 0, or sometimes if this limit does not exist at all, then it can be, we can conclude that the function is not differentiable there. Okay, so that's all about the idea or the very preliminary results of differentiability for a function of two variables. Now, is it clear to you, everybody, the idea of differentiability for a function of two variables?
Yes, sir.
All right, then today almost the time is over, but I am trying to introduce a result that is, you can say, the first important result of theorem in your syllabus, in our course of discussion. What does it say? I am writing it as a theorem over here. The theorem says that if fz is equal to, if fz is equal to uxy plus I into vxy, if f of z is equal to uxy plus I into vxy is differentiable at the point at the point z0, suppose z0 is equal to say x0 comma y0, then the real and imaginary parts, the real and imaginary parts, what are the real part? U comma y, and v x comma y is the imaginary part of the function f, are also differentiable there. If the function f is differentiable at the point f of z, at the point x0, y0, then it can be proved that the function u and v, these two functions are also differentiable at the point x0, y0. Today, as because the time is limited, I am not going to discuss the proof of this result. I shall discuss the proof of this result in the next class. Okay. But it can be proved that if a function is differentiable, then its real and imaginary parts are differentiable, and converse result is also true under certain conditions, of course. The converse result is also true under certain conditions. Some extra related results are also there in this discussion. That's why I am not going to start the result or the proof of this theorem. It is related to something extra. But before that, let me tell you a small result that says that if a function is differentiable, then it is continuous there. If a function, like if fz is equal to u plus iv, is, or simply you can say if fz is equal is differentiable at the point z0, if fz is equal is differentiable at the point z0, then it is continuous there. However, the converse result is not true. That means if a function is continuous, then it is not necessary that it should be differentiable there. Okay. So how to prove this result? The proof is a matter of two lines. Suppose the function is differentiable. What does it mean? It means that this limit should be satisfied. So if a function is differentiable, if f of z is differentiable, then this limit must exist. Or in other words, we can say that for any epsilon greater than 0, there should be delta greater than 0, etc., etc. So that can also be defined. But rather than defining this one, I am trying to, rather than defining and introducing this definition, I am trying to prove that the function is continuous there. Then what we need to prove, you see, if a function is continuous, then what we need to prove? We rather need to prove this result, that limit is tending to 0, f of z plus h, that should be is equal to f of z. Okay. Now, how to prove this result? Okay. How to prove this result? In order to prove this result, we can start with this difference. Difference of this one, this expression, f of z plus h minus f of z. And this expression, you see, this expression can be written in this way. If this expression divided by z multiplied by z. Alright. And you see, this expression, this kind of expression, and this is actually the product of two functions, limit of first function, limit of second function. And if the limit of both of these two functions exists, then we can write it as limit of first function and multiplied by limit of the second function, not z, I should write h over here. I should write h. So over here it should be h. And what is this? This is actually f dash z0 multiplied by h tending to 0, limit of h is equal to 0, so that is equal to 0. And therefore we can say, as because this quantity is equal to 0, so we can say that limit of this expression, limit of this this expression from this result, this is equal to 0. This is equal to 0. So we just remove this bracket, and this quantity does not depend upon h, so this is free of h. So we can take this f of z on the right hand side, and therefore we will have this type of relation. So it says, it proves that the function f is, I should write z0 over here. This is actually about z0. Okay. So in this way, we can prove that the function is differentiable, and if a function is differentiable at the point z0, then it is continuous there. Now, what about the converse result? Let us consider this example of this function. F of z is equal to, suppose, z bar means conjugate, that is actually x minus I into y. So now you see, we are going to prove that this function is not, this is a continuous function. We can prove all these results. That you see, you can verify this result, that this function is a continuous function. Whenever h tending to 0, now we can prove this result, that f of z0 plus h is equal to f of z0 for any point z0. But we can prove that this is not differentiable at any point. Particularly, we are proving this result, that this is not differentiable at the point 0 comma 0. Okay, so we consider z0 is equal to the point 0 comma 0. Okay, and therefore what is the x0? We can say that this x0 should be equal to 0, and this y0 should also be equal to 0. Clear? Now let us try to check whether the function is differentiable or not, that means whether this limit exists or not. Let us try to check this result. So over here, you see, if you consider this limit h tending to 0 f of z0, what is z0? Z0 means the origin or the point 0 comma 0. So we can simply say that this limit is nothing but this kind of quantity f of z0. Over here z0 is equal to 0, so we can simply write 0 over here. This is also 0, so 0 plus h means simply f of h minus f of 0 divided by h. Okay, and what is this f of h? This f of h, suppose h is equal to, let h is equal to, say, this kind of point H1, comma H2. Then you see this expression, this f of h, this f of h, if x is represented in terms of x minus I into y, this z is in place of z, what is z? Z is actually x comma y, you see, x comma y. So in place of x comma y, we have the value of the function is equal to x minus I y. So in place of h1 comma h2, what should we have? We should have h1 minus I h2. That is actually h bar. Got it? You see over there, f of h should be is equal to h bar. And what is f of 0? F of 0 should be is equal to 0. So forget about this 0. So we have this type of expression, limit h tending to 0, h bar divided by h. And what is this? H means h should be is equal to h1 minus I h2. And what is h? H is equal to h1 plus I into h2. So that is the final expression we have. Now what we need to do, h should tend to 0. Now suppose h is tending to 0 along any arbitrary path, and I am going to show that this limit does not exist. What does it mean? I am going to show that along two different paths, the value of this limit is different. So let this h is tending to 0, h is tending to 0 comma 0 along, suppose along the path, suppose h2 is equal to maybe m into h1, just like a straight line, y is equal to mx, say this is our y, this m into x, y is equal to mx. Then you see h1 tending to 0 means h2 tending to 0, so altogether h should tend to 0. So if we put h2 is equal to m into h1 in this limit, then what we have, this limit would be is equal to h, in place of h2 I'm just putting m into h1. Just in place of h2 I'm putting m into h1 over here. Okay, and take this h1 common. So over here I should write h1 tending to 0, over here h1 tending to 0. Now we can take this h1 common. What we have over here, 1 minus I into m, and over here we should have 1 plus I into m. One plus I into m. Now we can cancel this h1 because h1 is tending to 0, so it is not equal to 0. So what is the value of this limit? The value of this limit is this expression, 1 minus I into m divided by 1 minus plus I into m. And for different value of m, the value of this limit is different. So what we get for different value of m means we are following, for different value of m, maybe for m is equal to 1, we have one straight line. For m is equal to 2, we have another straight line, and so on. So we can say that along two different paths, the value of this limit is different, and therefore the limit does not exist. The limit does not exist means this limit h tending to 0 f of z0 plus h minus f of z0 divided by h, this limit does not exist. And so we can say that the function is not differentiable at the point z0. So please remember this kind of example, that this is an example of a function where the function is not differentiable. It is continuous but not differentiable. Okay, so I think I should stop over here.